you're talking today about CloudStack and Terraform.
Yes.
Everybody welcome, Robert.
Thank you. And has the camera started? Okay. Before starting the presentation, I have to start my very large demonstration because it runs for 20 minutes. Okay. And what you see now is already Terraform in action, I hope, at least. And what will happen here will be explained later. So I just have to, before pressing enter here and creating 38 resources in CloudStack, I will show you the web interface because it shows an empty project in CloudStack, okay? Just to make the before and after comparison. Okay, let me press enter here. And it starts creating things. That's fine. And let's see if something's happening here. Okay. See, already instances started. Starting. Perfect. Let's start with the presentation. Okay, CloudStack and Terraform. Why and how and okay, what is Terraform? Is anybody using Terraform here? Okay, please don't ask any questions later. Terraform does provisioning and management of your infrastructure. So it does not manage the single instance or the single virtual machine, but it manages the whole infrastructure on CloudStack. That's why we are here for, right? I'm coming from a company that also sponsors this event. We are doing IT consulting with around 35 people. We are running since 1992. And we, since 6 years now, we are also running this little email provider. You may have heard about it. And this is running partly on CloudStack and partly on VMware. So what is Terraform? Terraform offers infrastructure as code. It has a high-level configuration syntax in ASCII files. You can think about it as a blueprint of your data center. From that configuration, Terraform generates execution plans and shows what will be changed, as you have seen on the command line earlier. It uses a resource graph to parallelize calls to the CloudStack API so that by default, 10 resources will be created in parallel, for example. And it automates all the changes. So you, as you have seen, you confirm it and then it runs and hopefully will be finished after running. Where does it come from? From HashiCorp. You may have heard about HashiCorp. HashiCorp has products like Vagrant, for example, or Consul and several other things from the cloud ecosystem. I think they have quite a name. Terraform exists since 2014. So it's younger than Mailbox.org, for example. Now we started in February. And it has a current release. It's still a 0.0 release, so they still say it's not finished yet. It's written in Go, and it's open source, and has these websites. Okay. Why do I use it? I am a trainer for Ceph, for example. Besides other things, I'm a Linux consultant at Heinlein, so I do many things there. One of my roles is being a trainer for Ceph, and in this training course, every student needs the same environment. And this consists of 6 to 12 VMs per student. depending on the content of the course. And we have up to 9 or maybe 10 students plus me. So that would be much too much manual work if I wanted to create all these VMs with the network configuration and the disks attached to the VMs by hand. So I thought about that, and we have CloudStack, and I found a Terraform provider for CloudStack, and I tried it and it worked, and that's why I'm here now. What can I do? Terraform has several object types. One is the provider, that is the cloud system you are talking to with Terraform, and it has a provider for CloudStack, it has a provider for AWS, for Azure, I think, and for OpenStack for sure, and all these systems. And for the CloudStack provider, you need your API URL key and a secret key, and then Terraform is able to talk to CloudStack. Then it creates resources. These resources depend on the provider. So different providers offer different services, and Terraform maps these services to resources. So you have, for example, you have an instance resource or a network resource or an IP address resource or a disk resource. And you can build modules with Terraform configuration, so you can reuse things. You can call a module multiple times, for example, to create the same instance over and over again. Yeah, and these modules have input variables so that they can be parameterized. They have one or more resource definitions, and they have output values, so you get something back from your module. Yeah, for example, the ID of the instance the module just has created. And you have variables, so for example, the secret key can be put into a variable in a separate config file, for example, or it can even be read from the CLI in the interactive mode. So you do not have to store the secret key in your Git repo, for example. Yeah? You don't want to do that. This is an example of a network resource, and you see it's CloudStack specific. It has a zone ID, a project ID. You give the network a name and a display text. You can even define the IP range, the network domain, and you need to specify the network offering so that CloudStack knows what to create. Same with the instance, you have similar attributes for the instance resource here. You can pass an IP address ID if you have created an IP address resource beforehand, for example. And you give that a name that can be passed from a variable here in this case. And you can even pass the key pair for the SSH login after the instance has been created. A disk volume, also like this, and then you to attach the disk volume to an instance, you pass the instance ID here, and then the disk will be attached to the instance. And you can even specify a device ID here that is then mapped to the block device ID inside the VM, so that you know at what block device ID your virtual disk is attached. Okay. After Terraform has run, you have an infrastructure with the instances running attached to networks and disks attached to the instances, for example, but Terraform does nothing inside the created VMs. So after the VMs has been started, you start your Ansible, your SaltStack, your Puppet, your Chef to configure the instances themselves. Okay. Modules are subdirectories with a main.tf for Terraform file in them, and you need to run Terraform init to initialize a directory that contains modules. That is something that has to be done even after changing modules. That was something I had to learn. And this is a directory structure for my academy course, where I have a main Terraform file called Ceph Academy, and some variables like the secret key, for example. And then I have a student module that defines what is the infrastructure for the single student, so the learning environment. And the learning environment consists of up to 4 Ceph nodes and up to 5 or 6 client nodes, which are then similar but different. And they are therefore defined in separate modules. Okay. Terraform projects are the contents of one directory. So this is a Terraform project. And I would always map a Terraform directory to a CloudStack project, because Terraform is always defining the whole infrastructure. It reads every .tf file in the current working directory when run and creates that execution plan, applies all changes resulting from that execution plan, for example, adds new instances or removes instances that are not in the configuration anymore. Okay. The state is saved in a file, a terraform.tf state. That is quite an important file, because when Terraform loses its state, it does not know what is in the CloudStack project. But there's Terraform refresh to the rescue. You can read the project via the CloudStack API, and then Terraform knows what machines are there and the IDs and all that stuff. Okay, demonstration time. My first demo is quite simple. It has 2 files, underscore init and an instance file. And in the underscore init, the provider CloudStack is defined and an SSH key resource. Oops, that was not. No.
Okay, finish.
Yeah, okay.
Break time.
There was some automatic animation going on here. That's bad. Okay. I think you get it, right? You have a resource, and in the instance TF, we have an instance resource. I will show you the files right now. And let's see what is happening here. Ah, it's already complete. That's nice. That's faster than 20 minutes. Okay, we have, and I'll make it a little bit larger. I have this, my current working directory here. And we have 2 files, underscore init and underscore instance. And that's the init file. Yeah, fits on the screen. I can show you these secret keys, because I will destroy the project afterwards. Okay, so no need to take them down to write them down. So we have our CloudStack API here. We have the IPA key and the secret key. We have the zone UUID and the project UUID. And then I'm creating a provider cloud stack with the variables here and a timeout of 1 hour, because sometimes the API lags a little bit. Okay. And the first resource created here is my key pair, which the content comes from this file. So that's my default SSH key. And the instance is defined here. It's the instance is called instance 01, And you see here, I'm getting the zone and project ID from the variables. So, okay, I get a network offering here and a service offering, a template, which is a Debian 9. And the key pair is referenced by its ID. And the ID is composed by this path, I would say. It's a resource type dot resource name, and then the attribute name is ID. And so in this way, the resource for the instance can use the already defined resource for the SSH key. And then I have an output value, the IP address from my newly created instance. This will be printed on the command line in this case, and it's referenced in the same way. It's the resource type dot resource name, and then the attribute IP address. And this is a fresh working directory. It has only these two files in it. And the first thing to run now is Terraform init. Okay, Terraform is, I will not show you the installation of Terraform because Terraform is just a Go binary. Okay, and that's something very easy to install. I think it's in user local bin in my case. Yeah. So I'm running Terraform init first, and Terraform init reads the two files, and it sees a provider called CloudStack, yeah, and it needs to download the plugin for this provider. And luckily, we have a good internet connection here. Yeah, the provider for CloudStack has a version 0.3. And it's currently not in active development. So if anybody can write Golang and wants to take over that part, I would be happy. I'm not a Golang developer. So I think that would be very good if the CloudStack community could have a look at that at least. And Terraform then saves that plugin into the current working directory, and now it's ready to run Terraform plan, for example, that will show you the plan, or Terraform apply to execute the plan. What has happened is a .terraform directory has been created, and inside there's a plugins directory with the CloudStack binary. That's also a Go binary, and Terraform will use it to talk to the CloudStack API. So I could run Terraform plan, and it will show me the actions it would do. It creates an instance and the key pair with the public key read from the file. And here we have the key pair is only known after applying the plan. So I'm running Terraform apply. But before that, I will show you the project here. That's the CloudStack Day project, or also with zero instances currently running. And I think the timeout has somebody needs to tell me how to raise that timeout. But maybe that's a topic for the GUI talk later on. Okay, we have no instance running here. And now I'm running Terraform apply. And it tells me again the plan, and it says two resources to add, a key pair and an instance, okay? And I have to confirm that with the yes. And it's creating, and then runs for approximately 90 seconds. And we can have a look at the web interface. There's an instance coming up. It already has an IP address. And the SSH key can be found in the account sections. Okay, there's the newly created SSH key. So as soon as the instance is running, Terraform will report success. It updates its status every 10 seconds, as you can see. And it will now take some time. In the meantime, I could continue with the presentation, if it lets me. So this was the simple example. And the more complex example is my Ceph Academy, where in the main file, I also define a provider and the SSH key. And I have a module that is the environment for a student, and that's the, oh, crap. sorry, that's not, I think I will make it like this. And so I have a module for every student environment, and the module is called multiple times for the trainer and for the first student and the second and the fourth and the third, for example. And every student environment is defined in a subdirectory with two resources. Ceph needs a public network and a cluster network. And then itself uses the other modules for the Ceph nodes and the client nodes. And the Ceph node then uses resources from the upper module to create the instance. And the instance gets a second network interface, which is also a resource for Terraform. And the second network interface gets the network connection from the second network that was created in the student module. And we also create here several disks that are also attached to the VM. So let's have a look at the demo. Okay, has completed, was running for nearly 2 minutes, and it has created two resources. And here I have the output of the of my last file, which is the IP address. And now I can just log into that. I hope the instance has already started. Cloud init has been run, so my SSH key is already on the machine. And voila. So I'm on instance 01, so that's the name the VM also gets as host name. And in my CloudStack interface, I have one running instance. The second example has been creating 38 resources. You see several disks here that are all attached to different nodes, different instances, all in the trainer module. So the trainer module calls the Ceph node module, which itself creates disk resources. And this is the directory. And I'm using it quite simple. This is the main file, and this is a module for the trainer, which sources the file from the student subdirectory. And if I need more students, I just uncomment these lines here to create more modules. Terraform has the option to run loops inside the configuration, but I haven't figured out how yet. So okay.
You can just specify a count parameter.
Okay.
It's a global feature that I think is supported for all modules. and then you get a like a running variable that you can
Okay. In
the parameters.
I think I need to increase the student number here for my other modules and somehow it didn't work, but that maybe it was just me. And the student module is then creates two resources for networks here, and also can set egress firewall rules, for example, and then it creates the Ceph instances by using the CephNode module. And this could be also done with the loop, maybe, but as you can see here, I'm setting predefined IP addresses for my instances because I want to have really similar environments for all the students. So I don't want to have here a random IP addresses, but I want to have predefined IP addresses. That is also possible. And the Ceph node module then looks like these. At the start of the module, variables are defined that are empty, that are the input values for the module. So these are passed to the module as attributes or parameters, and you can even set default values and overwrite them when you call the module. And this module creates an instance, and then it creates a second network interface for that instance here, attaches it to the instance, and then it starts to create disks for the instance and attaches them, and takes the disk offering that is used, and it creates several disks, and all with a very specific device ID so that I know in the VM where which disk is located. And in the end, let's see, I think we hit a timeout here too, no? In the end, I have six instances running, four of them are Ceph nodes and two of them are client nodes, and all with specific IP addresses, as you can see here. And I also have the two networks here, the Ceph cluster and public for TN is for German Teilnehmer, sorry, for student number zero, and that's the trainer. And if I want to have more students in that course, I just run Terraform apply again with an uncommented module, and I get more machines and more networks. And yeah, that's it basically. I could show you this in the simple example. Yeah, I have a second, I could create a second instance here by editing my instance file. I'm lazy copy pasting it. And I'm renaming the instance here. And I also want to output the second IP address, and I think I have to rename that output then. And when I now run Terraform apply, it says, okay.
Yeah, the space is
there. Yeah, that's not good. Spaces are evil on the command line. Okay, and it checks what it already has been creating via the tf state file, and then it sees there's a new instance in the configuration that should be created, so it has one resource to add. And I just can confirm it here, and then it will go to the CloudStack API and happily create the second instance. Some time.
How does it differentiate? What's the unique key in terms of whether something has already been created or not?
It's the ID.
Okay.
It's always the UUID from CloudStack. As you can see, I have a second IP address now, and I can have a look at the Terraform TF state file. That's, I think it's YAML. And you can see we have the two outputs here, and we have the resources and the instances. And somewhere inside here, there's the ID from CloudStack for the instance.
Okay. So it's the provider that's defining that as like the primary.
Yeah. Terraform Refresh will refresh that information from the CloudStack API and will output my config again, my IP addresses. So, and then you have a surprise, surprise. No, that's the wrong window. Surprise, surprise, a second instance. And now the opposite effect is to remove the first instance from the configuration. And now running Terraform apply will tell me that it needs to destroy this resource. And everything goes back to zero or to null. And when I apply that, it tries to destroy the instance by stopping it and removing it. And as I had set expunge to true by when creating that instance, or the disks will be removed also. And yeah, it destroyed the first instance, and it outputs now the IP address from the second instance again, because that's the output of the plan. And there you go, one instance left. So that's Terraform. You define the infrastructure that should be available through a CloudStack project by telling Terraform which resources to create and how they are combined, attached. And then Terraform will create all these resources. The applying the plan for the complete course, like for 10 students, each having 9 VMs, for example, took around 1.5 hours last time. But it runs, yeah, and it finishes sometime successfully. And I don't have to do anything. So that's very nice. Okay, the last slides from the presentation are just some advertisements. that was my presentation. Thank you for listening. As I said, please don't ask any questions, because I'm neither a CloudStack nor a Terraform developer. I'm just a user. Okay, ask questions.
I have a question. Concerning the Terraform Refresh, that's always limited to the specific project you're working with.
Right.
It will also retrieve all the out of Terraform created VMs or objects.
It tries. There is a mode where you can import these resources into the Terraform state. What it mainly tries is to sync the information from the Terraform state file with the current setup in your CloudStack. And there may be other methods to build such an infrastructure with CloudStack. I think Ansible is also able to talk to the CloudStack API and create VMs and all that stuff, all the resources. It was the easiest method for me to create this environment for the Ceph course.
With Ansible, you would have mainly the problem you can't easily parallelize the steps.
Okay. Yeah.
So normally, how Ansible works is doing step by step.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this would take a long time.
Yeah.
Maybe.
actually, Terraform is pretty smart about creating resources in parallel.
Mm-hmm.
So when you define a variable that depends on another resource, it will automatically reorder them so the first resource gets created first, and then it uses the output.
Right. The order in the configuration files is not important. It's Terraform reading all that stuff in and then creating the execution plan.
Is there any way to build an Ansible inventory from the output of Terraform? Because as you said,
maybe yes. Yeah.
About creating the infrastructure, then you can use Ansible for configuring the instances.
Yeah. I haven't looked further. There may be integrations where you get output from Terraform feeding into Ansible inventory, for example. Yeah. But it's also a very simple approach for me. I just had to have something that allows me to create that learning environment relatively quickly and tear it down after the course. And when all these machines are created, I let Ansible run over the machines. So I have a different Ansible playbook for pre-configuring the machines so that the students can use them. And there's one thing missing from Terraform. There's no resource to create a VPN access to that isolated network I just created. See, I have that isolated network called PublicNet, where all the machines are in. And I want the single student to have a VPN to access their learning environment. And that has to be done manually, but that is something that's just 10 times creating a VPN and getting the VPN key from the CloudStack GUI. That is okay as manual work. Yeah? That is something I tried to ask the provider author, so the Terraform provider for CloudStack author, but that's when I got the answer that he wasn't using CloudStack anymore, so he has ceased the development. Okay, it's working currently with the basic resources, but if you want to have more, go ahead, fork the GitHub repo for the Terraform CloudStack provider and do it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you.